You're listening to E's Way Radio, one of the hottest radio stations in the world.
Keep it locked to easewayradio.com.
What's up, Burr? Yeah, man, this is Rick Knock, a.k.a. the Northern California King of Slappers, a.k.a. Senior L. Blaps Bastard Lee. And you're listening to E's Way Radio on easewayradio.com.
To the rhythm!
You better tell somebody.
Y'all know who it T.I. is, your boy Sir Mix-a-Lot, and you're listening to E's Way Radio.
Y'all know what time it is, man. Welcome to the E's Way Radio Show. It's your boy E-Dawg in the building. This is the 30-minute chop-up, and I got a legendary drummer on the phone. I told y'all about it on Facebook, IG, that I was going to be interviewing this man. He's touched everybody in the business. He's been on every stage in the world, and it's only right that I honor Brian Frasier Moore.
My brother, thank you, man, for having me.
Oh, man, you already know. This is like long due, man. I already knew in my head it was going to happen. And I was just like, yo, I got to get B on the. And then I looked up your Wikipedia, man. I never really did that. And I was like, man, come on, man. Come
God
on.
God is good. God man. Is good.
Right? So let's start from the beginning. I know this is going to kind of like make some thinking happen. But you started at the age of 5. Who got you into the drums?
It was kind of a family thing. You know, moms and pops was around the crib. My dad played guitar. My mom was a singer. And I grew up in church. So I guess the combination of all three of those, it was like, that's what I want to do. You know?
Now, was your parents very supportive of you doing this?
They were supportive. You know, in the beginning, they gave me my mom bought me my first drum set before, so I wouldn't have to beat on encyclopedias anymore. and then my dad, when I got older, maybe around 16 or 17, my dad co-signed for me a drum set to that. So music here and there, taking me to concerts, they were pretty supportive.
Man, that's dope, and that's all it takes, right?
Yeah.
Especially, so you were born in Philly.
Born in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
So how did you end up in L.A.? I know we're skipping a long part of the story, but how did you end up in L.A.?
So throughout the time that I lived in Philly, my early part of the career, I was always working out in L.A. And everybody was like, man, you need to come out to L.A. That's where it's happening. But I was so East Coast to the core. You know, I was afraid and all of that. And this going to trip you out. The thing that made me move to LA had nothing to do with the music business.
No way.
It had everything to do with my wife, Brandi Williams.
Are you serious?
Absolutely. Because I had already been doing, you know, gigs on the West Coast, and there was no real need for me to move. It was working from where I was. But when I met Brandi, it was like I didn't want to go back to Philly anymore. You know what I mean? I'm like, yo, I love this feeling. So she's the reason that I moved to LA.
Wow, that's some new news, man. I thought you was out of LA the whole time.
Nah. I was so against it at that particular time. I didn't know a lot of people on the West Coast, and work seemed to be working just fine, so I didn't really see a need until that Cupid arrow hit me on my body.
Say, yeah. Love, huh? Love would do some strange things. I said strange things, but strange, I meant. So here it is, man. Usually everybody got a connection, and then they get in the business, they get their first gig, and then, you know, the word of mouth is real big when it comes to drummers and stuff like that. Hard to keep a drummer too, because sometimes they be playing for 5 and 6 bands. So how did you get your first gig, and who was it with?
So my first official gig, you know, I've been playing around town in Philly, did a couple of you know, little festivals, hometown festivals with Jazzy Jeff and, you know, all of that stuff. But my first gig was, I don't even know if you remember this, you might remember this group, the White Hair Brothers?
No.
Okay. that's my point. But I was hyped, bro. I was so hyped. So I got the call for the White Hair Brothers, and the musical director at that time, he was from Philadelphia. His name was Johnny Crum, and he was getting a lot of work. So that was like my first introduction to leaving the house, going on the road, going on tour, going overseas. And that gig, that same MD, led me to Aaliyah and Genuine right after that.
Wow. So you came out the gate swinging.
Man, well, he was the MD. And that's just a testimony, you know what I mean, to like people that may be listening, is you never know where that next job or that next referral is coming, because nobody ever really heard of the White Hair Brothers. To them. But that led me to Aaliyah, Genuine, which led me to the next, and on and on and on.
Man, that's crazy. So you started out with, and that's when they were on top, right? Obviously, because Genuine came out and killed it, then Aaliyah came next.
Exactly. So Barry Hankerson had them on the same Budweiser Superfest. I know you remember that.
Yes.
But Johnny had both accounts, so we were playing for both artists on that tour. And I remember Timberland came out, and he said, this is funny. So I remember Timberland walking up and saying, yo, man, listen, just do the best you can, you know, because these beats are complex. And, he wasn't lying at that particular time. There was a whole wave of drum, but I'm from the church, bro. You know, we play upside down.
I was about to say that.
So, yeah, that was interesting.
Man, that's kind of cool. So you went on the road. Did you go on the road? Yeah, obviously it was a fest. So this is what I wanted to ask you, because I've seen countless women on your roster of Wikipedia, and I was wondering, the diva, did you ever experience the diva come out a lot of these women?
You know, respectfully, I think it's a part of the game when you play or perform or work with a female artist. Not that they're so impossible to deal with, but it's just the nature of it. You know, if I look at every woman in my life, you know, my wife can be a little diva. You already know. My mom can be a little diva. I think it's just a part of genetics. So yes, but in different ways.
Like, yeah,
you know, Janet is such a sweetheart. And but she's a diva, but she's not.
She's a perfectionist.
Yeah, she's a perfectionist, and I think that's how a lot of them show their diva, from Patty to Madonna to Christina to Janet to all of them, which I totally respect and enjoy. And it groomed me for my wife, to be honest. It gave me the patience, because look, you can't snap on your boss that's paying you now. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. You got to take those. I was going to ask you, since Janet is all in the news and all over the place right now, were you the drummer that night at the Super Bowl when that controversy happened?
No, I was not there at all. That was before, I think, if I'm not mistaken, that was before I got a chance to play with Janet.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I was watching that documentary, man. I stayed up all night and watched it, and it was frustrating because it wasn't A&E, so it was online, and they made you do these commercials like every few minutes, and that's what you had to do to watch it. So it was like, I stayed up for hours, and my wife was in bed behind me, and I know she's like, what is this dude watching this girl all night for? But I was watching it, man, and it was interesting because what I found out about her is she wasn't really that hardcore diva. She was so down to earth that she had regular people problems. And she had a lot of things go down with her that she bailed through, man. You know, like that controversy with the Super Bowl. She handled that very well.
Such a G.
Yeah, she handled that very well. You know, like I tell people, if you don't give them anything, they ain't got nothing to go off. They only got that actual story, and it stops there. When you try to fight it, then they're digging more and more, because controversy sells, right? So whether it's a success story or a bad story, it still sells, and that's all they care about is that bottom line.
Absolutely.
So working with, did you get the gig, the Janet Jackson gig through Justin, or was it the other way around?
Man, Janet Jackson, this is gonna be crazy, but I swear this is true. So Aaliyah, Genuine, Blase, fast forward, I got a chance to play with Usher. I went on tour with Usher. And by me going on tour with Usher, we had opened for Janet for the Velvet Rope tour. Right?
Oh, wow.
So fast forward ahead, I got to see the Janet show every night. I'm like a fan, and my homeboy was playing drums with him. So I'm like a little kid. I'm a cheerleader on the side. Like, yeah. Yo, this is crazy. I've never seen anything like this. Okay, fast forward. Janet's about to go out again on the All For You tour. And they needed a drummer. So they had open auditions. This was when Roger Davies was her manager.
Mm-hmm.
And they had open auditions. And my tech, one of my longtime tech friends, was on that gig teching already. And he called me. He said, Brian, I think you can get this Janet thing. They're auditioning some of the same arrangements that they play on the Velvet Rope tour, which I watched every night. I knew it by heart. So fast forward, I come in to the audition. They flew me out, and there's Janet sitting right in the middle. I'm paranoid. I'm like, yo, that's the real Janet Jackson. Guys, this is crazy. So they ended up playing, the audition piece was a 3-song medley that was exactly the same from the Velvet Rope tour.
And you already knew it.
I already knew it. So I played it. She's sitting there watching. She starts to get up a little bit and like do a little bit of dance moves. I knew all the accents that the dancers used to do. So I played it off, and then they said, thank you. Went home that day. The next morning, they called to say you got the job. And the morning after that, I flew out to rehearsals.
That quick?
That quick.
That's something I was going to ask you about, because rap is different, right? You go grab a mic. You play your instrumental in the background if you ain't got a DJ on stage playing it. And then you just grab your balls and you walk across the stage and you yell. Right?
Right.
So these big tours, these gigantic tours you guys are on, do you get some of the musicians you're familiar with most of the time, or do you get new guys and you guys have to learn how to be in sync and to conversate with each other and get things down? How does that work?
That's a great question. I mean, I'm thankful for kind of being in the musician community earlier in my career. So a lot of the bass players, guitar players, singers, and people like that I already knew or were familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
But there has been times where there was people that I didn't know, like playing with Alicia Keys, that might have been a guitar player that I never knew.
Mm-hmm.
And so the gel is interesting. You know, you have to gel multiple ways. Playing together, mentality, lifestyle, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, so it's really interesting. It helps my people skills. It helps me to be better with speaking to people and respecting people's space. And
mm-hmm.
It's an interesting conversation.
Yeah, it's got to be, man, because, you know, I'll be seeing 8 people up there sometime, and some of these productions get crazy, and I'm just like, these guys can't be getting along all the time. I've been on over 8 guys every day, and it's irritating sometimes.
Yeah, like Justintimberlake, we have 15 band members.
Damn.
And it was like, thank God that we're like brothers and sisters in every sense of the word. Because when you have family like that close, you're going to have disagreements. You're going to have arguments.
Mm-hmm.
But it's done. It's done like family. You get on my nerves. You know what? I'll talk to you tomorrow, bro. Just give me some space.
Yeah, it's just everybody's vibe, man. Sometimes people ain't mourning people. You know, yeah. Sometimes people get frustrated too easy. And in that kind of situation, though, I'm sure you have to be on your best behavior, because not only the word of mouth, but the artist might not, you know, this is your last tour. So usually they got their mind made up already.
Yeah. You know what I learned through trial and error, which is really interesting, is that no matter how much I might feel justified for snapping, for arguing or whatever, there's always somebody looking from the outside in that's only looking at my reaction.
Mm-hmm.
They don't know the backstory, so I could be justified with telling this dude off, but really painting a whole another picture for myself, possibly for the future.
Man, let me tell you, my experience, my first tour was the Baby Got Back tour. We went out early so that the record wouldn't hit yet, but I was from the streets, so I couldn't take no fakeness. It irritated me, and there was some fakeness going on that I just focused on too much, which I should have been focused on myself and the job that I'm doing. But I was arguing. I was bipolar. I was arguing at video. Like, you know, we stop and do videos on the road. I would be arguing with somebody in the group. I would be cussing Mix out. I cussing him out in the hotel lobby. I mean, FUs, all kinds of things. Man, I know he was like, man, this dude is crazy. What did I do? I know there was times where he was like, man, we get home, forget this dude. I mean, I was snapping. Like, you know, like it was normal to snap, like he wasn't my boss. But then when I got home, man, believe it or not, I didn't want to go back out. I didn't go on the second half of the tour because I said, this ain't what I thought it would be like. I wasn't ready. I don't think I was mature enough to go out, you know, because like I said, I shouldn't have been focused on other people. So that's why I asked you about getting along with band members, because, man, every day you got to see these cats, and there's always some habits that they have that you just can't roll with.
Oh, man. Yo, it's really like a family. I mean, this person sneaking people in and get caught, so they cut all the comp tickets. You know what I mean? It's
man.
It could be anything, so... Just a word of encouragement for people who aspire to go on tour, like you've been on tour, and other people that want to go on tour. You know, your talent is one thing, but geez, that personality and demeanor probably rules over top of that.
I think that if you go out on the road, you think business, you get more accomplished. But if you go out on the road and you just want to be a roadie and be down and mess with groupies and do all this stuff that doesn't even make any sense. You can get rich, man, because you come across a lot of successful people, business people, not just musicians and
people like that.
The contacts is crazy.
It's crazy. I mean, when I did, I think it was Rebel Heart, Madonna's Rebel Heart tour.
Mm-hmm.
I took that approach. I mean, the money was incredible, so I was like, you know what? I'm saving every penny, and I'm trying to make every connect possible, because I want to go home and feel like I'm rich.
Mm-hmm.
And so I met through business connections. I met up with this guy, Daniel Carazzi, who owned a virtual reality company. This was like 7 years ago.
Damn.
And yeah, so he wanted to sign me on as an artist, and I signed with them, and he was still trying to get the technology together. Fast forward 2 years ago, he came back to me, says, hey, I want you to be the U.S. Commercial partner team leader.
Wow.
So I have six employees under me. We're all on retainer. We've all been on retainer, and we got potential to make some really, really good money through our connects with, you know, different clients that we got on the line. So that's just a testament to what you were saying. Like, you can go out, be with all the girls and smoke all the weed and drink and nothing against that. But man, those business opportunities be out there, and you're on a level that people aspire to be on, so they take you serious.
They give you that conversation.
Yeah.
Just because of who you with sometimes, they give you that conversation, man, and they take it serious.
Yep.
Like I say, rich people that don't have nothing to do with entertainment want to have big entertainment friends.
Yes. Right?
So they want to invite you to the big parties. They want to call you. They want to talk to you.
Yes.
I mean, depending on what tax bracket they're in, they already know what you're making. They don't judge you for that, right? They just want to have those monuments in their house when they're doing something, or when they go somewhere, or you may want to learn about the business. I met a dude one time at a show, and he said I flew from Europe to come watch you perform. And I was like in Seattle and at the show box, and I'm like, yeah, right, you know, I wasn't taking him serious. I was like, who is this dude? Same thing with Suge Knight. I remember meeting Suge before Death Row. And he came and leaned on my shoulder at a California show, and he kept saying, "So where the chicks? What we doing? What we doing?" You know. And I looked up, and this dude was huge, and I looked over at Mix, and I said, "Man, who's this big old groupie on my shoulder?" And Mix bagged up and said, "Oh, don't be saying that loud. That's Suge Knight."
Right, right.
He knew of him. I didn't know of him. But you know, but just coming in contact with people, and I was mad because I should have had radio station people's numbers, program directors, all these type of people that you need when you start your own career. I should have had these people's numbers. But instead, I was focused on coming back with a bunch of girls' numbers. And now when I'm in the business, like, dang, I wish I could reach back because that guy might be this guy now. You know.
Yeah, it's crazy, that evolution of
it's of crazy. Being that,
that's a testimony too of, you know, not really shitting on people, you know, because you don't think that they're on your level. Who this guy? Oh, you just do the lights for the tour, you ain't nothing. And then that guy turn around and be the creative director for the whole next arc. You know, man. You just never know.
So how do you prepare for Janet Jackson and Christina Aguilera tour? What is your, what is the practice like, and how long do they last? You know, the majority, how long does these practices last before you go out?
I'd say on the average, anywhere from 2 to 3 months of rehearsal with Madonna. Each one of her tours, she does 3 months of rehearsal. So it's a production rehearsal. The dancers are in a separate facility practicing. The band is in another facility practicing. The lighting guys, they are all getting their stuff together. And then, like, the last month is a full production rehearsal. That's when everyone comes together and we're on the stage.
That's crazy. See? That's crazy. A couple of days, few days for you to grab your balls and grab the mic.
Exactly.
I mean, I put a skit in one of these mixtapes I just did, and it was Steve Harvey in one part where he was talking about rappers yelling over each other and grabbing their balls and telling you all the instructions. And he said, "Man, it's supposed to be a rap concert. I feel like I'm in a workout video." But yeah, a lot of performances, man, are down when it comes to entertainment business. A lot of people then got lazy. You know, I've got the chance to go see my boy. He's a promoter out here, and he bring acts. And you know, some of these acts need the money, man, so they do those track dates.
Yeah.
And it just ain't the same feeling.
Yeah, you know, I find that there's different levels in performance, you know what I'm saying? But just observing and watching different artists. And, you know, some artists are clothing, trap doors, video walls, this stage is turning. Then some artists is like, yo, just give me the, play the instant replay and give me the mic and I'm good.
Yeah, which is crazy because sometimes your performance can kill a fan. Or it can, you know, enhance a fan. Because I've seen shows where I was like, damn. Like Chance the Rapper. I really wasn't a Chance the Rapper fan at all. And then I went to the Bay, and my boy invited me to a show, and it was like 30,000 people outside. And this dude's performance was so incredible. I fell in love with his music because I understood it more, right? And it wasn't a big production, but he had about 4 people, but they were killing it. And he put his all in it. And I was like, man, if you don't like this guy and you see him perform, he's going to gain a fan. I respectfully, that was dope. You know, Mix always has his thing on stage where he says, "I don't lip sync." And he always says, you know, I come to play for you, not with you. And when I got older, I understood those words, what he was saying up close and personal. Don't turn no fan away. He's always, sometimes I have to tell this dude, man, you just gave that dude your phone number. What are you doing?
Right.
He's just that down to earth, man. It's like, oh, man, yo, take my number. Okay. I'm like, you crazy, man. And then he ignores all the phone calls.
his heart is in the right place.
You're right. So what artists, out of all these people you've been working with, what artists can you say that you've molded a super friendship with on a regular basis, every few weeks you call and check on each other?
Oh man, throughout my career, I have to say, I used to play with Goody Mob. Mm-hmm. And me and CeeLo, we still tight, man. That's my dude. We just actually text last week. Mm-hmm. Justintimberlake, we'll text from time to time, like, yo, happy birthday, whatever.
Dope.
Such and such and such. But back in the day, Christina Aguilera was like my little sister. Like, I've been to her house, she would fly me to her crib, comes out to this party. Damn. And stuff like that. But that's about it. I don't really feel comfortable getting too close sometimes, because
it does mess up the business a little bit.
Yeah, I'm still at work. No matter how cool I am, I still want to have that respect there. That's my boss.
No doubt. So what was it like with Aaliyah, working with Aaliyah? Did you guys, because she doesn't seem like, now some people, you know, some artists, they have production people around them to make sure they stuff goes smooth. Was she really involved with the band, or was somebody else involved?
No, absolutely. Aaliyah, God rest her soul, she was such a beautiful person. She was so involved. She was such a hard worker and a perfectionist, and she was all about the vision of her music, every aspect. And she was, I find that most of them are. Like Janet is super involved. Madonna is super duper. Justin is super. These guys are involved in every aspect, which I love.
Mm-hmm.
And depending on the personality, if you're a person that can't take constructive criticism, direction, mm-hmm. or anything like that, you're going to run into a problem. But I welcome it. I love it.
Man, that's dope, man. Again, y'all, this is Brian Frasier Moore, super legendary drummer. Look him up. Check his Wikipedia. Check his info out. Look him up, man. He's on IG. What are you on IG as?
BFM22.
Okay, and do you have a Facebook?
I have a Facebook. Yep, Brian Frasier Moore.
Yeah, and if you know, just look into this cat, man. It's unbelievable, the work, the body of work that you've been involved in. Now, do any of these guys ever call you when it's time to record an album and they need live drums or anything?
You know, that's a great question. Not really. The only artist throughout my time that I've worked with that I actually recorded something on the album was Christina Aguilera on the strip, her strip record.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I don't think it's that they don't want to, mm-hmm. but it's like a musician battling the producer, mm-hmm. so to say. Mm-hmm. You know, they have a sound. If you have Timberland as a producer, if you have Foster, if David Foster, depending on who you have, you're kind of battling their sound,
mm-hmm.
versus, you know, so I respect it, but that hasn't happened to, oh, Babyface. I'm sorry. There's a album called The Playlist record by Babyface, and he brought us in to play that whole record.
Wow, what is he like working with?
Man, I love him, man. That's my guy, man. Like, he's so down to earth, so cool. I remember being in the studio with him and Daryl, watching them in a writing session, and it was like, it was so dramatic and cinematic, bro. It was like the rain after the sunshine. But wait a minute, who said there would be or sunshine after the rain? I'm sorry, who said there would be sunshine after the rain? It might be more rain, you know, like that. Wow. Type of detail. So yeah,
you kind of see sometimes what I've experienced with some of these artists is you see why they are who they are. Like,
absolutely,
you just see it, man. They wear it, like, you know. And I tell people, I say, if you want to experience something great, go to LA, and nobody's off limits. The bar, you know, the bars, everything. You want to be next to shoulder with somebody, just go to LA and hang out. Just hang out.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like you see, like, you could see an artist and say, damn, he just got the superstar. Right?
Yeah.
Everybody don't have that. And then I realize when I watch these shows on TV and they say, you know, they don't make it through. And I go, yeah, it's just a natural talent that people wear. right? Like, drumming is a natural talent. It's not something you can learn all you want to, but I've seen people been drumming for 15, 20 years and they still just don't have it, right? They're good. They're good. They might play good in church, but they don't have it. I've watched them drum sets. Now, that brings me to talk about your signature drum equipment. How did that come about, man? I know you got some snares out. I've been trying to get one for years. I know you got some snares and things like that, man. How did you get into that?
Just pushing, trying to push the bar. I've seen some of my heroes, Dennis Chambers, Ricky Lawson, some of these amazing musicians and drummers throughout their career get signature product and moving into a whole nother business bracket to be able to reap the benefits from selling those units and not just being, here's your free drums, all right, cool, go play the drum. No, it's like, I want to staple my name and my legacy. So, Pearl, you know, I approach the companies like that. I'm at my companies. If they all hear this, they'll be like, yeah, you're right. I'll be at them.
Man, that's incredible. That's something that an artist needs to learn right there.
Yeah, absolutely. Because it's not that they treat you like a slave, but they sign you on as an artist. So you might as well act like an artist. You know, be an artist. They sign artists to their roster, so be that 100%.
Man, so when they do, like, do they ever do things like bring you out to showcase, to drum, when they're doing like a product gathering or things like that?
Oh yeah, yeah. Like the NAMM show, I'll come out, do performances there for my product, or clinics, or Roland will send me out to Canada to do like a six event little run at the different stores that sell their products. So like, I'm involved in all of that. I want everything.
That's dope, man. It's crazy, man, watching, because I can never drum. I just bought my son some drums, and the cool thing about it is, like I said, it has to be natural. I don't drum, but he wanted to drum, so I went and bought him some drums. And it's cool because I actually moved his drums to the hallway one time, and he was bugging me for like 2 weeks. Can you put my drums back in my room? Can you put my drums in the room? And he goes in there on his own, and he explores, man. He goes on his phone, he goes on YouTube, he's trying to get his own patterns down. Eventually I want to get him somebody to help him with it. My boy came over and he did some things with him, and he was like, yo, he got the natural, like, hunger to drum. But I you know, it's got to be natural, you know, like my daughter started rapping. I didn't know she rapped, right? But one day my wife was like, yo, go online on YouTube and look at this. And she was imitating me, and she was acting, and she edited the video and everything, and she was rapping. And I said, yo, she wasn't whack, right? So then I put her in the studio, man. She had two songs, and I had her going around town, man, and they were paying her a few hundred dollars to perform in the city.
Nice.
And she, with her two songs, but then she messed around and got in the boys and got pregnant. So I you know, and one thing I was being really firm about is not managing her. Just continue to be her father. I was gonna find somebody to do that part. So that we could stay, you know, daddy and daughter.
Absolutely.
But she kind of, now I got the studio at the house, she won't come in and record, you know. She's just like, but she's in school. She's got a baby. She's in school. She's moving into her new first apartment in a couple days. She don't go hang out. She don't want a club. She don't want to do none of that stuff. So I'm blessed in that part. And like
absolutely,
I told her, she's young. When she want to revisit that part of her life, she can. Rap music right now is getting a black eye, but I just posted the thing, man, on rappers that's died from violence, and it was more than 40 of them in the past 3 years.
Jeez.
I was like, yo, this is our own doing, you know, self-destruction.
Yeah.
You know, in the industry not allowing positive rap to be as popular as it used to be. So,
right.
You know, when somebody come to you and say, yo, I rap, it's like, okay, yeah. And then everybody rap now, right? So I'm in my 50 now, and it's like, yo, I rap. Yeah, my grandfather rapped too.
Right, exactly.
We got there. Man, it was cool, man, chopping it up with you. We went over about 5 minutes, but it's cool. The one thing I wanted to ask you to do is tell the people, like, if you're an aspiring drummer and you want to make it your professional career, what advice do you got for a young drummer coming up?
Oh, man, that's a good one. So to everyone who aspires to be that, whether you're a drummer, a musician, singer, whatever it is, first of all, it's definitely doing the work on your craft, like studying, researching, so that when you do get these phone calls, you'll have enough research and information inside of you to be able to deliver whatever. It'll cut down on you being unprepared, it'll cut down on you not knowing what to do. Mm-hmm. So definitely research, mm-hmm. believing in yourself. We're all afraid, we're all fearful, but you gotta believe in yourself in order to translate that energy over to whoever it may be. And then for anyone else who is looking for more detailed information, I have a consultation service, BFM Consultations. You can go to bfmworld.com and check out all the services. So we walk people through contracts, marketing, branding. I mean, we have job placement. You know, I get people go through the program and, oh, you know what, they're ready. Mm-hmm. I call up some of my connects and we send them out on the road.
Ooh.
You know, and to get that real-time experience. So definitely doing your research, honing in on your craft, believing in yourself, being a people person, taking the chip off your shoulder, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. All of that.
And what's that website again?
BFMworld.com. We have lessons, consultations, we have school programs, curriculum. We have everything on there, so, but yeah.
That's dope, man. You might get a job out of it. That's what's up.
Yeah.
That's what's up. All right, man. B, Brian, Frasier Moore, it's been an honor, man, talking about the many artists you've worked with and things you've endured out there, man. And it sounds all positive, man. You know, you've always been a positive person to me. You know, people go look him up, man. He's official, like a ref with a whistle. That sounds like an E-40 line, right? Anyway, man, you are locked into the Easeway Show on easewayradio.com. It's Easeway. I see it no other way. I appreciate you, B.
Appreciate you, man. Thank you for having me.